This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic. This is part B of simple interest versus compound interest. In part A, we use the simple interest formula to compute interest on an account that is compounded quarterly. This takes four different computations. And now in this video, in part B, we're going to use a formula called the compound interest formula to compute the interest on the same problem. So make sure you view the video part A first. In part A, we began with this problem. Mary and Tom both deposit $10,000 in account, but Mary just does it at 12% simple interest per year, whereas Tom gets paid quarterly. And we wanted to find how much interest is earned in each account after 1 year. Mary's was simple. We just used the formula I equals PRT, and we came out that she earned $1,200 in a year. Now, Tom's was more complicated because if it was compounded quarterly, each time his interest was computed, it was 1/4 of a year. So his time, instead of being one, was 1/4, and we had to do four computations. So it looked like this. His time was 1/4. He began with $10,000, and then we went through and figured out how much interest we earned at the end of every 3 months. And we found out at the end of the year, he earned $11,255.09. That's how much was in the account, which then told us that his interest was the $1,255. That's what's above the original $10 deposit. So what we found out in interest is that Tom earned $1,255.09 in interest after 1 year when it was compounded quarterly, whereas Mary had earned $1,200. So he earned, $55 more over the time of a year because it was compounded quarterly. But it took a lot of computations. So now what we're going to do is learn a formula for finding the interest when it's compounded more than once a year. And then we'll do the same problem, and we should end up getting the same answer. All right, if A is the amount of money in the account after the interest has been paid, P is the principal, how much you put in originally, R, again, is the interest rate, N is the number of compounding periods per year. So quarterly would be four times a year, N would be four. Daily would be 365 times a year, etc. And T is the number of years it's in an account. 1 year, half a year, 2.5 years, whatever. Then we have what's called the compound interest formula. A equals P, parentheses, 1 plus R over N to the NT. Now, you may wonder, sort of what these represent. Notice this R over N, so that's the rate divided by the number of periods in a year. So in our example, we had a 12% interest rate. It was four times a year. So 12.12 divided by four means really you were getting 3% every fourth of a year or 3 months. So it's sort of where this comes from. NT, N is how many times per year you're going to make the iterations, how many computations we had. In our last problem, we only did it for 1 year, so T was one, and N, that was 4 years. So that's sort of where this comes from. And this formula, if you want to subtract P, then you'd have the actual interest. So keep in mind, this tells you the amount of money in the account at the end of the year, not only the interest. So here was our problem. We want to deal with the compounded part of the problem. We already know that Mary earned $1,200 in interest. So when we did our computations by hand, we calculated that after a year, when he deposited $10,000 in an account paying 12% compounded quarterly, he earned $1,255.09. It took all four of those computations. So the question is, could we do this more directly by using this formula? So let's do that. If we look at the problem, The principal is still, he put in $10,000 in the account. The rate, that was the 12%. I'm going to put 0.12. N, how many times per year it's compounded? That would be quarterly, so it's four times a year. And how many years? T is still in years. One total year. So let's put that in this formula and see what we get. We have A equals 10,000 times 1 plus the rate, which is 0.12, over 4 to the nt, so that's 4 times 1. And if you know how to input that in your calculator, you could put that in. Make sure you see this is 4 times 1, not 4.1, so it's 4 times 1. I like to simplify it a little bit first inside the parentheses before I put it in the calculator, just because it's easier, unless I have like a graphing calculator, which I don't have on hand. All right, so first of all, 1 plus 0.12 over 4, well, 4 and 0.12 is 0.03, and 4 times 1 is just 4. So actually, this is, if I simplify what's in the parentheses and that exponent, I happen to get 1.03 to the 4th. I personally find it easier to do that, but you simply don't have to go through that procedure. You just have to be very careful with your order of operations and really understanding your calculator if you don't do that. All right, so then I need to compute this, and you're definitely going to have to, you don't have to, but it's a lot easier using a calculator. Otherwise, you'd have to do 1.03 times 1.03 times 1.03 times 1.03, get your answer, and then multiply by 10,000. Right? And imagine if this was 40, you know, you'd have to do 1.3 times itself 40 times. So let's go ahead and figure out what this is. And if you use a calculator, you have to know whether it does order of operations or not. If it does, you might be able to just put it in just like you see it. And how do you deal with, this is the times, right? But then you've only got the 1.03 to the fourth. I never trust my calculator, so I always do order of operations myself. So this is how I do it in my calculator, which is scientific calculator. And you might have different buttons in your calculator, but just in case you want to know how I do it, I know the order of operations I have to raise to a power before I multiply by this 10,000. So I'm going to start by writing the 1.03. And then you'll either have a button that has maybe something like a y to the x button, or you might have a caret button, something like that. Usually those are the buttons that means you're raising something to some exponent. So I put one of those buttons next. On my calculator, it happens to be a y to the x. I have the TI30XA. And then what power I'm raising it to is to the fourth power. And then I have to use an equal sign to see what I've got so far. And by the way, this is not an equation. This is just what I enter in my calculator. This is what I enter in my calculator. And I get some number, and then I want to multiply that. So I use the time sign by 10,000. So this is just what I enter in my calculator. And then I have to press, oops, I forgot. And of course I have to press equal on my calculator. So those are the keystrokes. I entered these keystrokes. These are keystrokes. Not an equation. All right, so when I do that, and I round it to the nearest cent, I end up getting 1125509. I actually have 0881, but when I round it, I get this. So this means that's how much money is in the bank. So I computed that using my calculator. Now let's look back. So if I want to know how much interest the interest, I'd have to subtract off $10,000, right? So my interest would only be $1,255.09. And does that agree with what we got doing it the long way? Let's look up here. Yeah, there it is, $1,255.09. So there's the difference. You could do it by the longhand, or you could punch everything in your calculator and do it. All right, so the compound interest formula is useful if it's definitely useful anytime you're compounding more than once a year. So we'll now do some problems where we're going to use the compound interest formula because that does make a lot more sense as opposed to doing it by hand the long way. This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic.